Let's dive straight into the intriguing world of royal affairs, specifically focusing on Prince Harry's recent claims, which have been attracting much attention. Prince Harry, who's part of the prestigious Sussex family, has made a rather sensational assertion. He felt as if he was a walking kidney transplant within his own family, a mere spare part. In his words, he was someone who was always given the tiniest sausage in the tiniest room to play sensibly in reserve. It sounds a bit dramatic, doesn't it? But let's delve deeper into it. These sentiments sprouted from what Harry refers to as a deep psychological dive, where he says he's always been the spare to the substitute, perennially stuck in second place, even in a race of a lifetime where he never really got the chance to compete. Harry laments that this sense of being a substitute also extended to matters of real estate within the family, where he felt he received the short end of the stick. According to Harry, he and his wife Meghan were consigned to a rather uncomfortable cottage on the grounds of Kensington Palace, while his brother William, along with Catherine and their children, resided in a place akin to a splendid museum. Sounds pretty disheartening, right? However, it seems there's more to this story. The unveiling of the Sovereign Grant's annual report detailing royal spending appears to contradict Harry's narrative. The briefing provided to journalists on this matter challenges Harry's perception of his position within the royal family. The details about the distribution of real estate in particular seem to provide a different perspective, contradicting Harry's claim of being mercilessly expelled from a larger, more comfortable residence. But here's where it gets interesting. Amidst this, Harry has penned a book, effectively his personal account of being the spare. He utilizes his experiences, such as his real estate allocations within the royal family, to underscore his feelings of being treated as inferior all his life. When Meghan entered his life in 2016, they lived at Nottingham Cottage, located within Kensington Palace grounds. Recounting those times, Harry writes about inviting Meghan to his home for the first time, a memory laced with a sense of inadequacy due to his living arrangements. I'm sure you'd agree that feeling embarrassment when welcoming a loved one to your home, especially due to its size or grandeur, is an emotion most of us would rather avoid. Well, Harry confessed he felt exactly this way when he first invited Meghan into his home. However, in a testament to her character, Meghan displayed no signs of disappointment, to Harry's relief. But let's paint a comparison, shall we? Contrast this to the time Harry and Meghan visited the current Prince and Princess of Wales, who reside in a sumptuous 20-room apartment in the palace, refurbished at a hefty cost of about $7.6 million, courtesy of the grant, of course. I know what you're thinking. Poor Harry and Meghan, right? The couple, successful but until recently on a lower income, had to navigate life as 30-somethings, perhaps even purchasing something from IKEA or paying for their own furniture. Can you just imagine? One brother lounging amid priceless art in a museum-like dwelling, and the other making do with a $99 polyester modular set. It would be a tragic comparison if it were actually true. However, the narrative seems a bit more complex than that. You see, there was, and still is, an equally large apartment adjacent to William and Catherine's that could have potentially been Harry and Meghan's, had they wished it so. This certainly puts a dent in the idea that Harry was perpetually relegated to second place. Insights from royal editor Richard Palmer add another layer to the story. He recently noted that a 21-room apartment, previously occupied by the Duke and Duchess of Gloucester for over 40 years, remains vacant. A tidbit, it seems, that challenges the narrative of limited royal housing options. Remember the humble Nottingham cottage with its lamp-lit rooms? Turns out, this was never meant to be Harry and Meghan's permanent residence, but rather a temporary setup during their early royal careers. Despite its small 17th-century cottage ambiance, it wasn't necessarily their final stop. In an interesting twist, it was reported that the Duke and Duchess of Gloucester were poised to vacate their longtime home, offering the larger residence to the Sussexes due to their higher status at the time. The story, it seems, continues to unfold. One might argue that every story has two sides, and so it is with the tales of Harry and Meghan's royal dwellings. While a substantial $6 million had already been spent on the refurbishment of the Gloucesters' former residence, including roof repair, window replacements, and asbestos removal, this plan hit a roadblock. You see, Harry and Meghan, it appears, didn't fancy the idea of living in London. They had their sights set on Frogmore Cottage on the Windsor estate. So, when we revisit the image of Harry and Meghan perched on their modestly priced sofa, the full story offers a more nuanced perspective. As the annual report from the Sovereign Grant indicates, the two brothers, Harry and William, weren't treated very differently in terms of housing options. Meghan and Harry could have opted for a lavish apartment if they'd wanted. Yet, as we've seen, Harry is no stranger to contradicting himself. He admits this in his writings, highlighting a phone call he made to his grandmother, Queen Elizabeth herself, requesting a new living arrangement. Just imagine dialing up the Queen of England to chat about your need for a new place. Continuing his narrative, Harry said that they did explore their housing options within the royal estate, only to find the alternatives excessively grand and costly to renovate. As we can see, Harry's account seems to swing between extremes. At one moment, their house was too small, then the other options were too large and pricey to refurbish. It's worth noting that the refurbishment costs wouldn't have been personally borne by the couple, but covered by the grant. The crux of the matter, as underscored by the grant report, is that Harry and Meghan were presented with a range of options, with the royal family extending many privileges their way, akin to a silver platter served by a liveried footman. Yet the couple maintains that their experience was far from easy. Adding to the royal housing narrative is the fact that the former Gloucester residence remains uninhabitable due to ongoing repair works. That said, it's safe to infer that the necessary funds would have been made available to Harry and Meghan to renovate this property, regardless of their heir or spare status. Let's consider this. All of Queen Elizabeth's children were presented with attractive residences. There's no reason to assume that the same wouldn't hold true for William and Harry. Sure, William might end up with a more valuable art piece at the end of the day, but is that really a deal breaker? Interestingly, Harry isn't the only one who appears to flip-flop on issues. As the grant report reveals, Prince Charles, who has often championed environmental causes, now appears to be straddling a line. On one hand, he drives an Aston Martin that runs on cheese and wine fuel. He even reduced the heating of the pools in his mansions. However, this green image is contrasted with the report's disclosure of 179 helicopter rides, 65 charter flights, and an unknown number of royal train trips, all amounting to almost 4 helicopter rides per week and more than 1 private flight per week. This raises questions about his environmental commitment. It seems that Harry might have inherited his father's contradictory tendencies. Both father and son appear keen to make a point, yet often end up undermining their very arguments. In his book, Spare, Harry tries to portray a narrative of feeling second best. Yet he could have had a 21-room apartment in Kensington Palace, and like his father, perhaps even made cheese in the Gloucestershire countryside while saving hedgehogs. But much like his father, he also extensively uses royal helicopters. Such contradictions indeed add an intriguing layer to this royal saga.